morning, Dr. Venkatraman Balaji Garu.
Okay, are you able to hear me? Good morning, Vice Chancellor. Good morning, Dr. Kumar.
My name is V. Praveen Rao, sir. I am the Vice Chancellor of the university.
It's an honor to meet you.
Oh, it's my pleasure. It's our pleasure, I would say. First of all, let me register my appreciation and thanks to Ramarao Garu and you, both of you, for making this happen. In fact, this is our first webinar series which we are organizing. We thought that because entire education process got disrupted, what we call it as the value chain of education got disrupted. Classroom to complete student to teacher or to the university. I think some new innovations have to come out, and we thought that when I discussed with Ramarao, he said that you are the most appropriate person to guide us in this direction, our staff, our faculty. Today, most of the people who have registered are our own staff, basically. And we have given access to ICR directors, the local ICR directors and other members of ICR institutes here. On behalf of my students, on behalf of my faculty, university officers, Ramarao Garu also, I welcome you in understanding the ecosystem and pave the way for future innovations and developments in the university. And we will be troubling you time and again for advice for any new initiative, digital initiative we take up, so that we look forward to your mentorship and advice in the future.
Thank you. Honorable Vice Chancellor, this is indeed an honor for me for many reasons, but definitely one reason is that you are heading a university headquartered in a city that I still call my home. Once again, it's an honor for me to make this presentation under your chairmanship, Professor Praveen Rao. You are one of the most distinguished water management experts, water technologists in the country. And your contributions to sugarcane irrigation management is extremely well known. I mean, it's not known not just in India, in many countries as well. And we are aware of the kind of training you underwent in Israel and how it contributed firstly to the state of Andhra Pradesh in improving irrigation and water irrigation efficiency, as well as in other parts of India, eventually rest of the world. And you are heading the university at a time when technologies that you have built and the technologies of the type that you built are most needed in different parts of the world. And today, the combination of knowledge with skills in any discipline is what policymakers are looking forward to. So it's indeed a pleasure for me that you are chairing this session. And your leadership, I'm convinced, will take this university from its present ranking in All India Ranking Framework to a much, much higher level, even higher level. So I'm very confident of that, because you are one of the few agriculture university vice chancellors in the world to grasp this problem of digital leadership in education and thinking of ways to move it forward. So with your permission, I also want to recognize the role that Dr. Ramarao has played in helping me to get in touch with all of you. And Dr. Ramarao has been a collaborator and friend for a very long time. I'm delighted to be able to link with you. As recently as last June, I was working with people from your university, Vice Chancellor, Dr. Veeranjaleen, who visited Vancouver. We hosted him for a day-long seminar. So once again, I want to thank all of you for the wonderful opportunity, Dr. Jagdeshwar, Dr. Sudhir Kumar, and others. And I will begin my presentation with, in case Vice Chancellor permits, I would begin the presentation.
Thank you very much, and for all your good words. And go ahead, sir. Kindly go ahead.
Thank you. So now I'm going to take you through a few. I mean, you know, slides have become important in all this modern day learning. So I'm also going to go through them. What I would do is, at a couple of points, I would break briefly and leave a few questions that you can discuss among yourselves. And in case those around the Vice Chancellor want to say something, It's a good opportunity. So every now and then, a total of 3 times, we will have breaks like this.
Okay.
So what I'm going to do, you know, is that I'm positioning my talk on digital learning and agricultural education in the context of COVID-19. COVID-19, as you know, has made an impact all over the world. I mean, no country is exempt, whether it's a developed, wealthy country or a middle-income country, a powerful country or not so powerful country. Nothing is exempted. And the disruption it has caused, we don't even know its full impact, but it has definitely had an impact on education. And that is where digital learning is now seen as some kind of a panacea for many of the problems and challenges that we are facing. So we will take a look at how it can work for agricultural education. Now, what is digital learning? You know, digital learning is actually, it stands for many terms, but how do we define it? There are lots of definitions, but the easiest definition is very operational. Digital learning is a mode of learning where you need a digital device to access all services, whether it's lecturer speaking, delivery service, assessments, certification. To access any or all of them, you need a digital device. And here, a digital device could mean a PC, a laptop, a tablet, or a cell phone. I mean, the cell phone need not always be a smartphone. It can also be a basic phone, but you need a digital device. And when you have the device, you are engaging in digital learning, and that today stands for e-learning or m-learning, mobile learning, or what in earlier days was called computer-based training. And professionally, many people like to call it technology-enabled learning. There are whole journals devoted to technology-enabled learning, or web-based learning, or online learning, or massive open online course. All these are different ways and means of referring to this particular mode of learning. In other words, e-learning, online learning, MOOC, in today's point of view, roughly refer to one category called digital learning. Now, in today's world, you find that almost 1/3 of students in developed countries, such as United States, Canada, OECD countries, almost 1/3 of students are doing at least one course in the distance mode. When I say distance mode, it's mostly online mode. In other words, as many as 70 lakh students in US are doing at least one course in online mode, and there are people who are doing whole degree programs entirely in online mode. And this proportion has been increasing annually. Although, if you look at typical universities in US, Canada, the percentage increase in physical increase of students is only 2%. Whereas in online courses, the increase is between 10 to 15% every year. So it's a huge increase. And what has happened is that COVID-19 has kind of pushed this transition into a rapid pace. In other words, if you looked at March 15th, there were less than 10% of people were in the distance mode when you take globe as a whole, including developed and developing countries. But today, almost 100% of the students are forced to go into online modes in a span of 2 weeks between March 15th and end of March. You know, this transition occurred. This transition of this scale has not occurred across the world at all. I mean, even in war conditions, First World War, Second World War, big wars, you know, there were some countries that were not at all affected. But here, nothing. Everybody is affected. Now, this rapidity of transition can upset many things. The Vice Chancellor referred to the huge disruption it has already caused. But now, as optimists, we should also look at how this rapidity of this transition can become an opportunity. We don't want to sort of try out experiments on poor students, but at the same time, we can create new opportunities without creating negative impact on anyone. Long ago, in fact, I heard this in a speech by Prime Minister Narendra Modi, that when he addressed one of the gatherings of the BRICS countries, he gave these three S's. He said the definite need of today, I mean, unquestioned need, is to build skills at speed and at scale. I mean, the S's, yes. And now I've added my own word, quality. We need to build knowledge and skills at speed and at scale, but with always with quality, because students cannot afford to come back again to the university because they missed high quality material or they did not get good quality material. Whatever we deliver now at high speed and on scale must also be high quality. Now, how can we create this opportunity? Now, this is where, believe me, in this space of change, India is actually very well positioned. I mean, it is something I stay very far. I stay 20,000 kilometers away, but I can therefore see a few things which you might take for granted, but which look extremely grand to me. What has happened is that 2 decades ago, India started to invest in technology-enabled learning. Smaller quantities, medium-sized quantities, etc. I mean, India has always been investing. One is, you've all heard of NPTEL, National Project for Technology-Enabled Learning. You know, it started with the IIT system. It has expanded to cover many more. And this is, in today's world, it is second largest output of open education resource. I'm flashing the word OER here, open educational resource. In English language, this is the second largest. As on date, it has over 40,000 hours of video lessons. Now, the only output which is bigger than this is that of United States. NPTEL is bigger than United Kingdom. Its output is bigger than New Zealand, Canada, and Australia combined, and many other countries combined. I'm talking of only one language, English language. So that's a huge quantity. Now, in terms of views on YouTube, NPTEL views are bigger than the combined views of Berkeley, Stanford, MIT, and most US universities. You can put 10 of them together, but the number of views on NPTEL is still bigger. So it's a really huge project that India has created. The other is SWAYAM MOOCs. You know, you're all very familiar with it, and I'm sure you're also teaching in it. SWAYAM MOOCs are among the 5 largest globally. In fact, it started relatively later, but it has outstripped most countries. In fact, if all things go well, by end of 2021, I expect that to be the largest in the world. SWAYAM Prabha, which started as a separate project, delivering videos to people who do not have access to high quality or high speed bandwidth through satellites, it's again a major supply channel. So these 3 together constitute a very impressive and very robust and reliable supply channels for delivering educational materials to students. At the same time, there are also television programs, which I won't go into. The private for-profit sector is a player, but it is still not a very big player. So in other words, India's public sector has positioned itself well in this context of disruption to meet at least one part of the demand chain. The Vice Chancellor referred to value chain as a beautiful concept in education. And at least part of the chain can now be supplied. And it is being supplied, we know. And going further, you know, the market size for online education in India is considered to be a large one. It was estimated some 2 years back that the size would be like 12,700 crores per year. That's by next year they thought we would reach. And it was already growing at 50% per year. You know how big that growth is, how fast that growth is. But with COVID-19, both market size and growth rate, in my view, have gone up. And in fact, I understood that Tata Consultancy, TCS, has offered its platform to the university for a period of time for free trials. Now, there are many such players who were waiting in the wings who can now really burst into the main stage as well. So India's market size for online education is large. The players are becoming stronger. However, one of the observations I've always made is that agricultural education sector is actually a minor participant in digital learning. But it's not in India alone. I'm talking of globe as a whole. You know, you should take a look at Class Central, a website, which catalogs every single MOOC known anywhere, offered anywhere in so many languages. So in their catalog, as of now, there are about 14,000 MOOCs on the offer. And less than 100 of them really relate to the topics that typically are taught in the agricultural undergraduate programs in countries like India, in the SAUs. The number, when you add food topics, you know, the number increases to about 300, because food and agriculture are placed together in many categories, but we can make a distinction between the type of courses we deal with, the ones approved in the Dean's Committee list, etc. You find that that number is actually very, very small. And later on, we'll talk about that. The famous land-grant college system is still not a very big player. But again, here, India has been a leader. You know, back in 2014, the National Academy of Agricultural Sciences came forward to collaborate with the Commonwealth of Learning to organize a session or to brainstorm the power of MOOCs for capacity building in agriculture. It was organized then by Dr. Devakumar, who is a member of, who had just retired as ADG and who's a member of the National Academy, a fellow of the National Academy, and supported by several others. And this is available online as Policy Paper 70. And in fact, a lot of data that Dr. Ramrao had produced while he was in NAM were also used in this particular paper. This paper, I was very optimistic about the power of MOOCs to advance education further in the scene of Indian agriculture. And based on that, you know, some of us went ahead and formed the Ag MOOCs Consortium in India. We promote in different countries, we don't ourselves sort of run it. So here, Ag MOOCs, as you can see, you can just visit agmoocs.in. You'll find that there are a number of courses. And this is anchored at Indian Institute of Technology in Kanpur, which led the Agropedia project. And so far, you know, in a span of a few years, this is not a heavily invested project, a minor investment, a few thousand dollars a year. It has led to over 80,000 registrations, and two-thirds of them active, and almost one-third receiving certificates. What we find is it's a unique result that in MOOCs, generally, the certification rate is 10% or less globally. Whereas when it comes to agriculture sector, it's almost one-third. That's because, you know, agriculture students appear to be far more motivated than typically engineering and management students are, or that they are lacking the opportunities. And in India, there are many institutions whose students are participating very actively in this. I mean, as you can see at the top is your original name, and followed by a number of institutions here. I mean, from all across India, there are several institutions. So we are very pleased to see this list. And this has led to, we started with experimenting with a platform called MOOCIT, and it has been built comprehensively by Professor T.V. Prabhakar and his associates at IIT Kanpur. It's one of the very few open source MOOC programs in the world. There are only three, in fact, Canvas, MOOCIT, and OpenEdX from MIT. And this particular platform could handle very large number of students. In single course, back in 2016, there were 57,000 learners. As on date, it's used for offering 44 MOOCs and online courses as we speak. And it includes a very advanced webinar and video conferencing facility. In fact, it has been used by IIT Kanpur to run thesis defense during this period. It includes a blockchain certification system, and its mobile app is very popular. It can also deliver at very low bandwidth. That's one very big advantage. Now, here, you know, I've given just an introduction to digital learning and the opportunities that India has, especially the agriculture sector has. Now, at this point in time, I mean, you're all in wherever you are, think about the following. Have you attended any online course? Have you ever done a MOOC yourself? Now, I ask another question. I mean, I know that there is a lot of rigor in many mainline courses, but can you offer extension courses, courses meant for practicing professionals or extension workers online in agriculture? So this is something you could think about. Maybe I will pause here if the Vice Chancellor or the team around him has any comment on these two issues. We can take 1 minute and then proceed.
Anunada.
Yes, I'm able to hear you, sir.
Yeah, I think we haven't had a urge or we haven't asked our faculty yet to attend any online MOOC course.
Okay.
But one relevant aspect which I can bring to the notice of the speaker is that I think last year or last before year, we had a meeting in ICRISAT.
Okay.
Wherein we have invited people from IITs and all MOOCs who were the prime players at that point of time were invited to ICRISAT, wherein I was also part of that meeting.
Okay, sir.
We discussed their threadbare because people have come from IIT Mumbai, IIT Delhi, IIT Kanpur, okay, right. IIMs and all that.
Yeah.
So at that point of time, what we understood is that the way the MOOC courses were being run in
right.
IITs,
yeah.
in the physical
right.
sciences and other sciences,
correct.
The same ecosystem may yeah. not straight away be adapted to agricultural sciences. That
correct.
was the opinion of the experienced people. When
okay.
we explained them how we operate, what is our ecosystem, what
right.
type of applied aspects we deal with,
yeah.
what are the practicals we conduct in what we call in the labs, in the field.
Yes.
So
yeah.
they opined that I think we have to have a serious thought about it, and we have to discuss, and we have to come up with a different module. That was
okay.
the opinion.
But
that is one
okay.
thing which I think I wanted to bring to your notice regarding the first question. So I am aware that IIT Kanpur has earlier sent us some several mails asking
yeah.
us to participate, wherein some MOOC courses on plant
yeah.
protection aspect were designed.
Right. Yeah.
Okay.
That's
so we were a bit apprehensive about that. So we haven't drafted any of our staff at that point of time. Probably.
Right.
Because
yeah.
there wasn't any urge or there wasn't any
right.
Reason. If they, probably if this would have at this point of time, if the same thing I received, probably I will send a score of them to that program.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Okay. So that is one thing which I wanted to share. Now coming to the second, I think this is one of the most relevant
yeah.
thing today. Keeping in view how we can transfer our scientific knowledge
correct.
Or the technologies that have been developed in the universities
right.
As quickly as possible, as effectively as possible to the field level staff.
Correct. Yeah.
Okay, so
yeah.
I don't know. I'm yet to still. That's what I said, that the disruption has taken place so much.
Right.
What would be, we always over the years recommended that the extension workers should go and meet the farmer, say what you call, explain him, understand
right.
his culture,
right.
say bottom up approach. That was our emphasis.
Right.
Now in this changed scenario,
yeah.
No physical contact extension has to
yes.
be the prime drive.
Correct.
Okay,
this
so
is-
what model we will be. And another important aspect is, since there is a change in the way we are looking at the agriculture. Earlier there wasn't any connection between agriculture and food, but
right.
now we are looking at value chain from field
correct.
To the fore.
That's
so traceability,
right.
health, everything is coming into the agri-food system is now a different platform
correct.
Altogether.
Correct.
So in that context, I think this will be a very relevant aspect which we have to seriously think and develop an appropriate module. Say what you call, because most of it is through agro advisories, say what you call some video techno video modules, the interactive modules with the farmer, decision support systems. I don't know. I'm just mentioning few of them. So probably the second one is most relevant. And just 2 days back, we were discussing about the agriculture policy in the state with the Honorable CM. And
right.
this aspect also has figured there. So CM is now seriously thinking in view of the COVID, that I want to talk to all the 600 say mandal agricultural officers through online
video conference. Okay,
through video conferencing. And he mentioned as well that I don't know whether I can contact, I can have such a impact what I can have when I see them directly. He expressed this apprehension as well. So the second one is more relevant now.
Yes.
And the first one from the faculty point of view and the second one from the point of view of technology transfer. Both are very relevant points and we have to look at them seriously.
Very kind of you, Vice Chancellor. That's a very, very dynamic way of looking at the situation and responding to that. So, I mean, the idea here is that many of these things are highly doable. A lot of medical practice in North America also takes place where one surgeon, while working with a patient, is also assisted by a surgeon via very high quality, high definition video conference. So there are many of these things are taking place. Thank you for your kind words. Now, if you permit, I will move on to my second part, where some of these will be discussed further. Is that okay, sir? Can you see my screen? Can you see my screen?
Yes, yes, yes. Please go ahead.
So now I will take up in the second part. Let's start with what are the principal considerations when you apply digital learning? So this, the man who recruited me in Commonwealth of Learning, Sir John Daniel, is an ace figure. He's considered a father figure in the world of open and distance learning, like the way my former boss and mentor, Professor Swaminathan, was considered a father figure for many scientists in the Green Revolution era. So Sir John Daniel came up with the idea that there is an iron triangle. You know, it has three sides and three vertices: access, quality, and cost. Now, if you try to improve costs, if you try to reduce cost, it can distort the triangle. Often access may go down or quality may suffer. When you try to improve quality, it might reduce access or increase cost. And when you increase access, it might reduce quality or it might raise the cost up. For example, you know, when you allow more and more people to participate in a course, let's say, quite likely that the quality might decline. At the same time, the cost of managing the course could go up. That's just one example. And if you try to reduce the cost, what may happen is that you might not be able to guarantee quality. You know, the access may be more, lots and lots of people will have access, but you might not be able to meet the quality. This is true even in non-digital world, certainly true in digital world. So they cannot easily be, this is one of the big puzzles today that we are not able to break through. So if you improve one, it's quite likely that you are distorting the other two. So he called it an iron triangle. This is always a consideration we need to keep in mind. Quality is everything. In a typical research university like yours, quality is everything. You cannot allow anything to distort quality. If so, what happens is the class sizes have to be small. The distance mode will always be considered a dubious, doubtful one. And the other possibilities, you know, the possibilities of doing student peer-to-peer mentoring, etc., will be considered contributing to lowering the quality. So that is one very important perception coming from typical research universities. Now, when we look at another aspect, there are three dimensions in digital learning. One is that there is a teacher and there is a student, so there is a learning process. So teaching and learning are two dimensions. Now you add technology as a dimension. What happens is that, like in many organizations, when you introduce technology, technology can start reorganizing everything else to suit itself. So it has that particular property. Like this is what is called business process re-engineering. Like, for example, you introduce networks and computers and email in an organization. What happens is that a lot of work moves in the direction of doing email. And I'm sure most of you, including the Vice Chancellor, spent quite a bit of time in answering emails because email has been introduced. A bit of time that would go into meetings now goes into emailing. So technology has that particular character. Now, there are many theories of teaching and learning. And there is cognitivism, there is constructivism, there are any number of isms, but they're all based on the idea of typical classroom, a face-to-face situation, or a situation where the sizes of people interacting is relatively small. So lots of these theories exist, but whereas technology enabling is a recent phenomenon, and there are not many theories. There is a theory called connectivism, built up by somebody in Canada, Stephen Downs and others. It's a very controversial area. In effect, it means that there is no real theory behind how to teach in digital learning area. And for any theory that you quote, people can produce counterexamples. So this is still an emerging area. We will have to keep this in mind. But what happens is certain things we can very easily appreciate. One is that technology is a very powerful mediator. Wherever it is introduced, it has a tendency to reorganize everything around itself. And the technology that we are talking about in learning is A, interactive. And secondly, it is mediatic, meaning it's media rich. And it's personalizable. You know, all these three are here, and they're definitely part of any learning technology paradigm. And now it also generates huge quantities of data. I mean, because every interaction can be converted to data. If a student clicks on one part of the screen, that's a data. If the student sends a mail to the instructor, that's another data. You know, and so on. There's no limit to the number of interactions, and the vast quantity of data that gets produced requires special analytical tools, and the whole branch is called learning analytics. So, and the other important part, I cannot stress the importance of this more. Media, it's a very, very powerful media technology. Now, we will keep returning to this again and again. Just keep in mind that media, again, is, if technology reorganizes everything around itself, media also does that. And in learning technology, we have a combination of these two. So that's one point we need to keep in mind. And here I'm showing you, if you're all able to see my screen, a diagram from a very eminent writer and thinker called Tony Bates. I'll be referring to him later also. If you see media richness, you have low richness, relatively lower richness in, say, radio, telephone, or Wikipedia article, or a face-to-face seminar. These are very low in media content relatively. And you have somewhere in the middle, you have TED Talks. I'm sure you have listened to TED Talks, you know, technology, entertainment, design kind of talks. They are somewhere in the middle. And MOOCs, ex-MOOCs, the type of MOOCs that I mentioned earlier, you know, these are largely video lectures. They are somewhere in the middle. But as you go towards the right here, right in this, YouTube has educational materials which are copyrighted and often not reusable. And their media content is much higher. Video content is much higher. When you have mobile learning with modern video systems, I'm not talking about TikTok, but with many other systems, it's increasing. And when you reaches the world of 5G simulations, virtual worlds, it's extremely high. So what happens is that as the media content goes up, that tends to dominate the entire learning process, not just the content designer, the whole process is around that. Like when you have a lot of video with YouTube, you know, the whole interaction pattern tends to change compared to working with Wiki and the seminar. So now, how can teachers succeed in this realm where media is very powerful, technology is very powerful? Because many of the faculty enter a typical agricultural university for doing extremely good research. They are not known for teachers. Their research record is examined, their research record is assessed, and that is the basis for inducting them into the faculty. This is the case. Well, that's why agricultural university is typically a research university first. However, you know, in today's world, what has happened is that because of the way technology media interact with each other and are bundled into technology, learning technology, there is a need for capacity building for faculty also at different times. I mean, the idea that as a great researcher, I can impress a small class of 50, 60, 75 people is a good idea, a very powerful idea. It does work in that situation. But when the class size goes up or the distance mode kicks in, technology becomes a player. Capacity building is necessary for faculty. And two areas where we think they should acquire definite proficiency are, one area is digital skills. You know, digital skills are very, very important. Simple skills like improved office productivity software like MS Office, etc. then even essential photo editing to some extent, and being in a position to record a reasonably good quality, not studio quality, but reasonable quality. They should be able to judge what how good is a particular video, their own video. The other is that they need to acquire a lot of soft skills, because in this realm, pedagogy has fundamentally changed. No one knows how much it changes, but people know that it changes fundamentally. And they need to tutor, mentor people. Again, that's also very, very different. So they need to reacquire a whole lot of soft skills. Empathy with learners is, for example, a very important skill. The other is responsiveness, because even in North America, very, very experienced researchers who offer courses, I've heard them complain that with the advent of learning technology, there never is a rest time for them. It's 24/7 because people are constantly bombarding them with questions, queries, comments, etc. Their social life is affected. I've heard from very many senior people right here in Canada. But it's good to acquire that soft skill. One is digital set of digital skills, another is a set of soft skills. That is the capacity building part, besides being able to handle the media part. And as I said, one part of the skills come from digital blend of digital and soft skills. But the other part comes from skills in online social media. You know, online social medium, you know, I'm sure all the faculty members are using WhatsApp. And I'm sure their students are also interacting with them occasionally on WhatsApp. It can't easily be stopped. And social media, again, among media is the most powerful, overwhelming one. You know that, for example, I live in a country who's to the south of my city. It's a country whose president often makes policy announcements only on social media, I mean, Twitter. So President Trump does not make policy announcements through a cabinet meeting, but mostly through Twitter. So social media is extremely powerful, and it is a beast whose nature must be understood, and the faculty must become reasonably familiar with it. Or what can happen is that a wrong move, a simple error on the part of a faculty member, a simple mistake, now because of social media, can be amplified, can be retained forever. That's one more reason why, you know, two sets of skills: digital soft skill on one side, skills in online social media, are very important for faculty to acquire. Where this is coming from? This comes from the fact that today students are far more resourceful. In fact, one of my governing board members, he's the president of Royal Melbourne Institute of Technology. Earlier he was vice chancellor of British Open University. So he used to say that the biggest change factor in education today is the student, because the biggest change has occurred at the student level, not just at any other level, because the biggest change is in the student's personality and outlook. Students in general tend to be more advanced in social media skills and have generally their digital skills are more advanced compared to typical faculty. And because of that, control over learners is much less compared to the face-to-face situation when you are delivering online learning. And in fact, again, one more diagram here from Professor Tony Bates. And the extreme left is where the teacher tightly controls. It's typically like what we have in the agriculture university today: test, books, lectures, credit. Very tight control exercise by the teacher. That's called objectivism in teaching theory. On the extreme right is the connectivism, where, you know, there is no credit-based learning, but a lot of learning taking place. That's where you can see social media like Facebook is. That's where you see a lot of blogs are, etc. And in between them, you know, you have somewhere today, you know, we are in the area where I've kind of shown my circle. I mean, you know, we may attempt to use Moodle. We may attempt to give webinar the way we are doing. There is still a lot of control that the teacher can exercise. But what happens is that we are actually moving from where the first circle is more towards the second circle. And we are not able to help it, because the students are mostly here in the second area. The moment you go online, they are there, but they are in the further to your right. And whereas we try to move them back towards the left. So there is going to be a constant struggle between the two kinds of interests. And again, here, although we won't pass, I want everyone to think about this. that is access to web a serious constraint among students in your university? In other words, is access a serious problem? Please keep thinking about that. And how will you overcome that? That's the implication. The other is, how will you respond or adapt your style of teaching when your students use social media to comment on course content and delivery? Because you know, in every North American university, the students don't students have constituted their own clubs for every course, and some courses have 500 students. So 500 students have their own Facebook groups. They are exchanging a lot of information, and the faculty have no way of entering those groups. So in fact, in one experiment, earlier experiment, I pretended to be a student. I got into one such course. And later I reported to the faculty the comments that were being posted there. He was aghast. He wanted to quit the job. But so we comforted him, saying that the best way is that you know how people are talking about this, and instead of reacting to that, change your style. So he did and started to feel much better. So I wanted to leave this thought with you. And this is something, you know, our faculty who are listening to this could think about it, even in hypothetical situations. Let me now move on. And now we spoke about what faculty must necessarily acquire and why capacity building is important and how social media skills are becoming very important. What can institutions do to succeed? One is that institutional support systems are absolutely necessary. Like you say, you are a research university, and today you know how important it is to have access to a library. I mean, you may have less than 1,000 PG students, but those few hundred students still require access to a very good library, because the faculty career is also dependent on it. So in the same way, in a similar way, we need institutional support systems to advance digital learning in an agricultural university. There are lots of media production facilities typically in an SAU, but they may require to be reconfigured, because normally very few faculty members, only select groups are using them. But now when you open up digital learning and ask every faculty member to participate, you know, more flexible arrangements are necessary, more decentralized arrangements are necessary. The exact nature will vary from one university to another, but you need those things. The other is that institutions, when they move online, try to move all the sophistication of assessment systems in face-to-face directly into online. Now, this has led to large-scale failure for many faculty, many courses, and many systems. So again, I would say assessment systems need to transition more gradually. Start with simpler ones and then move on, while always guaranteeing the integrity of assessment systems so people don't get an opportunity to manipulate it, because the quality of the university is very much dependent on the integrity of its online assessment systems. And one that is equally important to prevent fraud at various levels is identity management. For example, you know, we have the Indira Gandhi National Open University with over almost 30 lakh students. It's one of the largest universities in the world, not just Open University. I mean, today people count them together. It's one of the largest universities in the world. And now, is there a way that the university has to track every unique student? No, because the registration systems are kind of fragmented. So often they are not able to give the unique identity to one student and see the same student in multiple courses. That's just one example. So every university must need to develop an upfront and institution level identity management system. This is going to be very, very important. And last but not the least on this slide is cybersecurity considerations. For example, you know, I knew that the Ministry of Home Affairs in India issued an advisory pointing out that Zoom as a conferencing platform was not very secure, and they would not recommend that. And many governments have actually banned Zoom for meetings among officials. I mean, in fact, when I deal with some of my donor countries, when I offer to come on Zoom, they will not let me come on Zoom. They will say, you know, they have big blue button, they have blue jeans, etc., or even Skype. But many of them don't go in that direction. That's because there is something called Zoom bombing, where, you know, people can crash into a Zoom conference, show pornographic videos, etc., upset everyone. This is called Zoom bombing. A lot of these disruptions have occurred. And therefore, the university authorities must pay a lot of attention to cybersecurity. Increasingly, countries like India are very concerned about where their data of their citizens is kept, who has access to them, etc. And as a result of which, for example, you know that India is one of the few countries where a big power, technology power like Amazon, was forced to set up its own servers, because India is a large market for Amazon, and the Indian government decided that the citizens' data as purchasers, buyers, cannot be maintained in a country where third party can have free access, study our patterns, etc. So Amazon has opened a data center directly in Mumbai. So the Indian government is very particular about these things, and universities should also reflect that. Now, I'm coming to two slides which talk about the leadership matters. One is that at the leadership level, there is a need for a recognition that teaching now in the digital learning paradigm has become a specialized activity, in fact, a highly specialized activity like research. Therefore, the models that were used for research setting, face-to-face teaching in a research setting, are no longer applicable. There's a fundamental change that's coming up when we go in this direction. And the faculty needs to be carefully incentivized for acquiring skills. We are not talking of monetary incentives alone. The leadership can think of a variety of non-monetary incentives as well. And the most importantly, technology purchase, acquisition, and deployment is also a specialized activity. It cannot be handled routinely by a purchase department alone. Again, a lot of leadership skills need to go into that. And all expertise cannot be found in-house. A lot of outsourcing would become necessary. And this is where, collaboration with consortia would be very helpful. In fact, Dr. Ramarao, when he was director of NAIP, has seen how variety of consortia brought together synergized strengths. And Dr. Praveen Rao would also know about a variety of collaboration projects we had with between India and US-based institutions. Now, coming to Office of the Vice Chancellor can make a difference. In fact, Dr. Praveen Rao as Vice Chancellor can make a fundamental difference to the way the erstwhile Angro and now the Professor Jayashankar Telangana State Agriculture University will work. One is that digital learning has a big advantage. It's highly scalable. You can have 20 students, you can have 2 lakh students. It makes no difference. And the same set of platforms and procedures would work. So no difference between on-campus, extended campus, and non-campus learning. They've all become one, because space has no meaning in this particular in this particular paradigm. So you can now offer credit courses, which you are doing, but you can also offer non-credit courses. In fact, this is where a lot of industry is looking for intellectual inputs from the university through non-credit courses. Imagine a fertilizer company now approaching you for a variety of training programs, which now can be offered online as non-credit courses, right? And that is where a lot of revenue also comes to various universities. Like, the world of IT, one course in cybersecurity can be charged 2 lakhs to 3 lakhs. I mean, it will be a one-year course, but people are paying. In fact, companies like Qualcomm in Bangalore are paying crores of rupees to IIIT in Bangalore only for a short course on cybersecurity. That's just one example. The other is that the Vice Chancellor's office can foster a services delivery attitude as opposed to a face-to-face teaching where the guru is instructing a student, a disciple. So that attitude needs to be cultivated both among teachers as well as among the support staff. This is why, when I've been asked to provide specific recommendations, I've generally recommended creation of a new office or center to foster and support digital learning. For example, it can be a dean or an associate dean charged with promoting digital learning. As you know, from our own part of India, from Telangana region, Dr. Sanjay Sharma, who's now Vice President of the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, it's also the head of their digital campus system. In that capacity, MIT has given him a vice president's grade and role. So they give that kind of importance. So those offices need to be created, need to be fostered. That's the vice chancellor's consideration, can take care of that. Lastly, regulatory bodies, you know, they can make or break anything. And agriculture university works, I know, with in India with the Indian Council of Agricultural Research. But there may also be indirect ways through which they are connected to UGC. In fact, what I find is that in a country like India, there is an increasing tendency not to allow fragmentation of professional universities. So there is an interest in integrating them more into one large higher education framework. And they can play a very important role in accreditation, quality management. But when they're charged with so many things, you know, they're often not sensitive to infrastructure and access limitations. They may try to impose the same requirement on every single campus, every single department, every single center. So we need to negotiate that with them. This is why we say, you know, someone like Professor Praveen Rao can take the lead in forming a consortium for digital education in agriculture, which then it's an informal loose body that can help enter into a dialogue with the regulatory bodies. And many universities today give recognition for online courses, credit for online courses. In fact, this trend is very strong in North America, and it's going to spread to other parts of the world. You can proactively think about that and find ways. The other is that for technology acquisition, etc., the regulatory body needs to create a framework for the paradigm as a whole, rather than specific particular technologies, because technologies change very easily. Like 5 years back, everyone said Blackboard was the end of the world in learning management system. Today it's gone because it's overpriced, it's gone. So things change very rapidly in technology. What we should be looking at in regulatory level is the framework, not particular technologies. Mm-hmm. So lastly, I'm almost at the end. In agriculture and digital learning, my own submission to you all is that land grant colleges have done what wonders for us in India, as you know, Canada is part of the land grant college system. So they have influenced agricultural education teaching in India for over 50 years. But today they can no longer offer a model in online learning because they are themselves lacking in the kind of pioneering spirit needed for moving in digital education. And international intergovernmental organizations like FAO, CGIAR are also not in a position to offer new directions because if they're also linked to land-grant college system in this sense. This is where, you know, we have great experience available nationally, a variety of projects, variety of initiatives from Ministry of Human Resource Development. And even the ODL sector, open and distance learning sector, although they are also in they have not faced disruption as much as other universities have, so they can offer some thought. I would say the PJT SAU can be a leader, should be a leader, and can move from its present rank wherever it is to the top 25. Because I read a statement that the finance minister has allocated special monies for offering online degrees by top 100 universities. I know that your university is in the top 100, so you're already empowered. I mean, all you have to do is create the support structures, leadership structures, and move ahead. So now this is time out for discussion, and this is where I will stop. Vice Chancellor said a few questions may be asked. So thank you, and I will later share with you a couple of resources. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. I would say that I'm extremely happy, and why? Because for a single reason, that you have already given us a direction and a clarity, which we were actually suffering, I would say. I was really in a dilemma, how to move forward, how to proceed, and how to build this ecosystem. Now, I think a lot greater clarity I could see from this presentation, and I'm really extremely happy. I'm telling you, I'm extremely happy to thank you for this time, presentation, and in a very structured manner, say, starting from the basics to the application, the say what you call the pitfalls, what we expect, the hindrances, the bottlenecks, obstacles, and as well as where we stand and how to move forward. So really, I'm very extremely happy. Thank you very much, sir. Now I leave the platform to Ramarao Garu. He will summarize at the end. Before that, I now make the platform open to the participants. If anybody wants to ask questions or seek clarifications, you are welcome.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. I'm very grateful.
Sir, good morning, sir. This is Sudhir, registrar from Agriculture University, sir.
Sir.
Yeah, we have gone through your lecture, sir. We were having a lot of apprehensions, but most of them have been cleared by you, sir. But still, I have two or three clarifications, sir.
Yeah.
So one thing is there any possibility to conduct practicals also on digital platform? One. Second one is there any way to conduct theoretical exams on a digital platform?
Please go on. Yeah. And so two questions,
sir.
Yeah, thank you. You know, in terms of practicals, there are various methods coming up. There is no final method. You know, there is something called haptics, where, you know, you manipulate things on a PC. But whereas in the remote area in a lab, actually experiments can happen. For example, simple question of titration. You can control the pipette, you can control the burette from your computer, and you can decide the exact drop strength. And it can happen in real time, and the results would be available to you. So that is called haptics. It's a science that is advancing, and a lot of investment has gone in. And today, haptics is indeed used even in medicine. But as you can imagine, it's a very, very expensive way of doing it. You need a lot of power, in computing power, bandwidth, and equipment, etc. But it is indeed taking place in limited areas. University of British Columbia in Vancouver, where I live, is one of the leaders in this area. That's one. So in theory, it's possible. But between where we are now in Hyderabad today and where we should be, there is some distance to cover. Now, you can also use simulations. Simulation science today is very advanced. In fact, if you look at drug discovery, pharmaceutical science, you know, we are all talking of in the context of COVID. A large part of vaccine development today is taking place with simulations, because you can simulate the structure of a very complex protein molecule. And you can use three-dimensional simulations to arrive at the binding sites and then decide on the exact molecule that should bind. So that's also taking place. But these are already real. When it comes to theoretical tests, as I said, assessments, you'll have to proceed very gradually. Today, you have very advanced learning management systems that can do let you do extremely complex computations. But they're also expensive. So as a university which is planning to reach a stage of excellence, this is one area where you need to experiment with faculty as well as with students and move ahead. Opportunities are many. Thank you.
Yes, please, any other question? So there is one more question which we received through message, sir. Can the faculty create their own courses? This is the question we received through message.
Right, yeah. You know, depending on any MOOCs management system, like MOOCIT or OpenEdX, the faculty can create a course in a relatively short time, very easily, autonomously. For example, I will even give one example. We got a call from Government of New Zealand saying that they wanted us to build an initial 3-week course for teachers on making use of simple techniques, like how to use WhatsApp, how to use this, I mean, Google Apps, etc. So this course, I gave the responsibility to Dr. Tony Mays, who's from Britain, who's a faculty member here, and access to MOOCIT. In a span of no more than 1 week, he created this entire basic course. And then he circulated the content to more than 10 experts in different parts of Commonwealth. They certified that this is indeed accurate, can be given. So in a week's time, we are ready to launch the course. So this course will start on 15th May. So you can work very fast, you can work quite autonomously. But remember, Vice Chancellor has an obligation to ensure quality at all costs. He will never give up his responsibility for quality. Therefore, we have to have layers where the content is quality checked. Thank you.
That's what he has answered now. Another question, any other question? In Zoom like apps, what type of data can hackers able to? Okay, you have clarified, sir, but there is one more question which says, in Zoom like applications,
yeah,
what type of data can hackers be able to steal?
Okay, right. So in Zoom, there are various ways, at least two ways where people can steal data. One is that all our all the proceedings of Zoom in professional meetings gets recorded, right? And the recordings reside in Zoom servers, not with us. I mean, we can also download a copy, but they will always have a copy. And those things contain a lot of discussions that would be of, I mean, you're not a company, you're not obsessed with secrecy, but if you're a company, you're discussing things that are confidential. Zoom company has access to them. They may be trustworthy, but what if someone breaks through into that? What if someone gains access to that? That's one. The other is, in today's world, photos with full identities like email, etc., are considered extremely sensitive and private. Now, people can grab your image along with your full particulars like your email ID, login, passwords. So with that, a lot of damage can be done. So those are just two areas. Thank you.
Okay, Ananda. Can digital learning be tailored according to the last question, sir? Can digital learning be tailored? Can digital learning be tailored according to the learning ability of learners? Like slow, medium, active learners.
Oh, that's wonderful. In fact, that's why I said, if you see one of my slides, we said it's a personalizable technology. Personalizable means you can sort of either through the instructor's personal knowledge or by making use of learning analytics, you can speed up or you can slow down. You can set the pace. In fact, often in AgMOOCs, you know, they keep studying the learning analytics to see that they mark a student, say, this person is going to drop out because we see his attendance going down, forum postings are going down, assessment grades are not coming through. So there is a risk that this person will start falling. So what they do, they proactively contact that person, ask what is wrong and what they can do to improve, etc. So in other words, you can link the two. You can use data analytics to give counseling. You can even set automated systems to track and help the students. And you can pace up or down, because flexibility in digital learning is a given. In other words, compared to the type of face-to-face situation with very tight timelines, in a digital learning situation, you know, you can be far more flexible. Thank you.
Just to give you an idea, sir, what we have done, our director planning and monitoring in collaboration, coordination with the deans. During this COVID period, we have done a quick survey.
Okay.
With regards to this, because we have conducted several online courses to the students. So we wanted to take a feedback from them, actually what they feel and so on and so forth. We have done a very quick survey. Excellent. We have preliminary results. We have preliminary results. Just I will share with you.
Please.
I will take a minute. What is their opinion about the internet connectivity signal strength in your place?
Right.
We found that 60% of them said that it is sufficient.
Okay.
But nearly 40% of them opined that it is poor. So the point made by you with regards to the digital infrastructure at the rural level is really an impediment today. So this we have to look at.
Right.
Then we have also asked them, how do you rate your e-learning on scale 1 to 5?
Yeah.
So we found that was a very high to high, about 30% of the students, neutral about 40%. But still we have 25% who said that low to very low.
Okay.
So, but I'm happy that nearly 75% of them have opined that neutral to high. So that means, this ecosystem will, they are of the opinion that in future it will serve them. That is, what is the average time you are spending per day on mobile phones or e-learning, we have asked them.
Yes.
So we found that nearly more than say what you call 80% said that 1 to 3 hours they are spending.
Okay.
Okay. So and then we have also asked them whether they have any problem of headaches and so on and so forth.
Okay.
So it was 50-50%. That means from the health point of view. So because we know that the screen is glazed, more bright, and particularly iPhones and all that. Then we have asked about, the last one was, which was very important. Do you have any computer, laptop with internet facility at home? So 85% of them have said no. So this point, it emphasizes the point made by you as well. So during the extended lockdown period, you are comfortable with continuation of online classes.
Yeah.
So satisfactory was 50% and 20-25% was high to very high. Again, 75% is favorable. So they are satisfactory. Though it was a very initial attempt made by the university, I think I'm quite happy with the feedback given. And mind you, sir, this feedback was from rural
people,
polytechnic students. We have done it. We are yet to do it from the graduate postgraduate students. This was from N+2 level students who are undergoing agriculture polytechnic. So this gives a bit of comprehension of what we are in and how we have to move, what type of people we have, learners we have, and so on and so forth. So I thought that I will share with you. I will come back to you with more information as we complete the survey for the undergraduate students and postgraduate students.
Thank you very much, sir. Grateful for it. These are all very impressive results. It also shows how systematic your university is in collecting data and acting on it rather than acting on suppositions and hypotheses alone. That's a very, very big advancement. Thank you. I would be grateful if you could sort of share with me the results at the
it is a preliminary data which has been sent to me by the director of P&M. So once we analyze it completely, one more thing which I want to say is this idea has been generated by a newly admitted assistant professor during the last year.
See, that's, you're encouraging people to play that role. It's very, very important.
So another point which comes to the fore is, as you rightly said, that the what we call the Z generation, who are born after 1985,
are
more advanced because they are born in a digital world. They are more acquainted with it. Whereas the teachers who were born earlier and brought up in a different ecosystem are still the problematic lot what we have in terms of digital, learning and so on and so forth, skills and so on and so forth. So this, now you have a gap. Now we have to bring in these two onto one platform, which is a challenging task actually.
Sir, lots of people have faced and they don't know what to do. So if you do something, you're going to be a global pioneer, because most people don't know. I mean, they simply report the problem, whereas you can find a solution.
Thank you very much once again, sir.
Dr. Balaji.
Dr. Amaravati, please.
Very sincere appreciation. You have given a global overview of what is happening in digital learning, as well as digital learning that is pertinent to agricultural education. So I would like to just to sum up a few takeaways from this to this university particularly. Now, you have clarified where we stand with respect to MOOCs and the last hidden talent in the university as well as in the country that is available on the e-learning. Remember that this university was forced to jump into this e-learning in a span of
you know, with 3 days notice. By that time, students are already out, faculty are at their homes. So they were asked to quickly move on to e-learning mode, and they did it. And most important appreciative part is that this university has been doing it as an action research.
Right.
And they pushed the content, transferring the lessons to the students. Simultaneously, they also undertook within a span of 4 weeks, what is happening really on the teaching learning. Right. They have done for polytechnic students, and the graduates is almost complete. I hope they will sum it up and share it. Now, you have raised very important things like this technology, including role of media in education. Simultaneously, the learning lesson for this, when we plan to do skill development for the university, we do remember those three dimensions: skill development in technology, soft skill development, and also skill development on social media. The last part is, by and large, kind of a thing. There is no institutional arrangement for training anyone on social media. Very sincere thank you for this one. And you also raised very important thing on institutional governance and leadership issues. Because since we are jumping into it at a rapid pace, disruptive mode of getting into the university system, how the university vice chancellor office and the top management will try to drive the university in preparing the educational policies and also educational administration. On my personal behalf, I sincerely thank you for highlighting these issues. Over to you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. And hopefully, I wish you and your family and your friends there to be safe from this unprecedented, or I don't know how to define it. We are still struggling to, and I'm happy that India, and more particularly Telangana, is doing well in as far as COVID problem is concerned. We have less deaths. We have less everything is in control with the administration doing excellently. And Telangana state also is doing very good in the agricultural front, for in irrigation development, in food grain production, and all that. As far as productivity also is concerned, university is supported very well by the government, and my entire staff is also doing well. Now we want to move on to the next level. So, and this, I hope that this enlightenment given by you for our staff, for our university officers and everybody will be very helpful in changing their attitudes and putting their efforts in learning these digital skills, and whatever best the university can do in creating an enabling environment for them in terms of infrastructure, in terms of training and capacity building, in terms of coordination and connections between the other institutions who have these capacities. I think we will come back to you, sir, in this regard. And I, with my folded hands, I thank you very much for all the help you have rendered at a very short notice. Thank you. And I
thank you. I'm very, most grateful to you and Dr. Ramarao and all your colleagues there. There are many. And my friends, some of whom I still know very well and maintain contact with in the university. I'm deeply grateful. And believe me, I work with a large number of universities. This is the only agricultural university in the Commonwealth which has even asked for this kind of ideas. You're the only agricultural university in among 54 countries.
Thank you very much once again on behalf of all my people.
My good wishes to you, to your family, namely the officers and staff of the university and students, for your continued well-being and good health. And I'm very grateful to hear that the state government has gone out of the way to ensure safety and well-being of citizens, and ensuring prosperity of agriculture. I'm very grateful. Thank you, sir. Thanks for the opportunity, all of you. Bye-bye. Thank you.